Join me, Matt Connerton, weekdays, 4 to 6 p.m. live for a discussion about politics where we put aside labels like liberal and conservative and have a discussion about truth and what's really happening in the world.
Hey everybody, this is Rob Azevedo from Granite State of Mind reminding you to tune in every Friday night at 6 o'clock for live in-studio performances by some of the very best artists from around the state. And don't forget, rebroadcasts are Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. and Monday and Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. Granite State of Mind on WMNH 95.3 FM.
This hour on WMNH is proudly sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 171 Londonderry Turnpike in Hooksett. Serving all your employee benefits planning, design and administration, investment and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. They are available at 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
You are listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, broadcasting at 95.3 megahertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA.
Today, but it was long ago. Billy Bush egging me on the bus. There in the darkness, we were boys doing boy stuff. The tic tacs that we shared, the mounds on which we drooled, acting like a wild man out of control. Till I was on Howard Stern just to talking about my moves. And I remember how they squirmed away from me, how they swore they'd see me in court again. I remember how I grabbed them both so tight. Wish nobody knew now I was on a hot mic then. Against their will, I was groping against their will. I'm older now, but still grabbing against their will. Yes, I'm older now, but still grabbing against their will. Against their will. Against their will. See the old man groping against their will, grabbing against their will, against their will. What's the old man grabbing? Against their will, groping against their will, against their will,
against their will,
against their will, grabbing and groping against their will, against their will.
See the old man groping
against their will, grabbing against their will.
My name is Glenn Joliet, and I live on Joliet Street in Manchester with my little macaca Richie and my uncle Nikolai, who was exiled to these United States after leading the unsuccessful rebellion against the Carr Trust in our native Newfoundland. I was born on the tripartite international bridge between East Eden, Newfoundland, Ovaltine, Quebec, and Van Buren, Maine. So technically I have three nationalities and three passports. Four, actually, if you count the honorary passport I won from the Trump Organization when I was a contestant on The Apprentice. I don't understand what all this fuss is about the public pissoir. Sorry, public toilets. Back in East Dayton, Newfoundland, my hometown, if people have to go, they go. Even in winter. I mean, dogs out in the open, don't they? Richie out in the open before God and everybody. Sorry, Senator, I'll use the word poop from now on. Yes, Senator, that's correct. The doggy bag for picking up poop was invented in Newfoundland. What most people here in the States don't realize, it originally wasn't for dogs, but for people. Pooper Scoop is banned in Newfoundland as a public nuisance. Otherwise, we Newfies would use them as slingshots. Back in Newfoundland, it's against the law to force people to use public pissoir. Excuse me, Senator, public toilets. It's discriminatory. If you have to go, you have to go. I mean, that's why we have all that green space in Newfoundland. All the public parks. What do you think keeps it green? We Newfies banned pesticides after the First War. That's World War I, Senator. The Great War. You got into that one late, too. You Yanks are so puritanical. Of course I picked up my own poop. Don't everybody? Public toilets are for sissies and old maids. Why be ashamed of your bodily functions? Everybody in the world everything in the world mostly right out there in public. It don't take no degree from Harvard to know that, Senator. Donald Trump is public. I've witnessed it myself. He uses a doggy bag, extra, extra large sized, embossed with the Trump Organization logo. In fact, I got a bag right here. We can send it out for DNA testing. No, I'm not Russian, Senator. Though he did appear on The Apprentice.
You're fired.
Speaking in public, I thought that's what a politician's job was. Oh, I stand corrected, Senator. On the public. I say close down the public pissoir and issue everybody doggy bags, extra large size. This seems like a healthy, well-fed community. People don't skip on their bowel movements here, I bet. No, Senator, I never slept with Donald Trump, but I did sign a release. Mama's little macaca. I find your ignorance of foreign tongues to be racist, Senator. You're a racist. That's racist. I'm not a racist. How can I be a racist? I'm from Newfoundland. This is a service animal, Senator. Macaca means monkey in Portuguese. I think John Cabot was Portuguese, the guy who found Newfoundland, who found all of North America. You know, you Itais, you have a lot of nerve claiming you found this place. My monkey was named after my cousin Richie Ashburn, who's in the Hall of Fame. Not the Baseball Hall of Fame, Senator. The Cod Hall of Fame. C-O-D. Why not read the Treaty of Ghent that created these here United States? It's all about the cod. Skin it back. Haven't you ever eaten a banana before? That's how you keep it clean. That's how Richie keeps it clean. Richie is very clean, though he does like to fling his poop. Is it hard like a coconut? Richie likes to play with his coconuts. Oh yeah, Richie really likes to play with his coconuts, Senator. Why are you so upset with Richie? You act as if you've never seen a monkey masturbate in public before. Poop ain't the only thing Richie likes to fling. I'm sorry, Senator. Richie understands four languages, but he cannot be called on to testify. He can chatter like you politicians, but he can't actually speak. Savvy, Senator? That is correct, Senator. I am a lineal descendant of Poop Deck Pappy. Popeye's Pop. I thought everybody knew that Popeye was a Newfie. I thought everybody knew that Popeye was born in Newfoundland. Actually, Senator, you're right. Popeye was born in a cod boat 2 nautical miles off of East Eden. That's close enough. Have you ever over the side of a heaving cod boat? Senator? No, Senator. I've never known anyone in Newfoundland to get frostbite on their bum, let alone on their private parts. Public toilets are for tourists in Newfoundland. You know, for you Yanks. I am a U.S. citizen, Senator. Why won't I say American? Senator, why don't you take a fly to Rolling Donut? The word about Don is you already did try to take a fly and the moon. That was during your last campaign for president. Sorry, you thought everybody knew that. I apologize. Yes, Senator. Poop Deck Pappy was born in Imperial Russia at the end of the 19th century. Yes, Senator. Poop Deck Pappy is technically a Rothschild, as you put it. What are you insinuating, Senator? If there is an international conspiracy of us Rothschilds, tell them I'm still waiting for my dividend check. Why isn't Queen Elizabeth on my U.S. passport? Senator, if you get fresh with me, I'll knock your coconuts together. I resent your deprecation, Senator. Queenie refers to Elizabeth, too, not Lindsey Graham. You. Kiss my bum. Senator, if I fell over the side of a heaving cod boat out in that freezing cold Atlantic and I was drowning, I still wouldn't you, even if you full of oxygen. Public toilets spoil people. Public toilets promote weakness. We're gonna keep those public toilets closed.
Nothing went on in Trump world, especially the campaign, without Mr. Trump's knowledge and approval. I remember being in a room with Mr. Trump, probably in early June of 2016.
He's a weak person.
When something peculiar happened. Don Trump Jr. came into the room and walked behind his father's desk.
And what he's trying to do is get a reduced sentence, so he's lying.
And I recall Don Jr. leaning over to his father and speaking in a low voice, which I could clearly hear, and saying,
"The meeting is all set."
And I remember Mr. Trump saying, "Okay, good, let me know."
Okay, when you read the parts about the Russian government or Russia supporting your father, did that put off any sirens in your head?
Honestly, I don't know. I mean, I think this was, again, just basic information that was going to be possibly there. I wanted to hear him out and play it out and see what happens. But, you know, people are trying to reach out to you all the time with this.
Did you tell your father anything about this?
No. It was such a nothing. There was nothing to tell.
Oh, okay. They didn't mention. Nobody believes that. He knew about it. He knew about it. He totally knew about it.
It was literally just a wasted 20 minutes, which was a shame.
He knew about it.
Nothing went on in Trump world without Mr. Trump's approval.
He knew about it. They mentioned. They didn't mention at one of their meetings. I don't know. Look, it's called life. You got to be smart in life.
I am going to give a major speech on probably Monday of next week, and we're going to be discussing all of the things that have taken place with the Clintons.
They had the impression that they were going to be told some information that you had about the DNC.
Yeah, it's quite possible that maybe they were looking for such information. They wanted it so badly.
How long did it take your staff of 823 people to think that up? And where are your 33,000 emails that you deleted?
Because she's deleted at least 30,000 emails. Which, by the way, should be able to be found.
Russia, if you're listening, I hope you're able to find the 30,000 emails that are missing.
He knew about it. He totally knew about it.
Okay, good. Let me know.
No. I have nothing to do with Russia, but...
Are you scared that you could go to jail?
I'm not, because I know what I did, and I'm not worried about any of that, you know?
The meeting is all set.
You know?
In the White House, oh my God, I'm president. I'm so rich and I'm an ass, and there's a wig on my head. I just FaceTime Putin. I told him I'm his biggest fan. Got so much scandal on the front page. Holy shit, let's build a wall. Ooh, oh, I can tweet so well.
North Korea.
Happy Friday. It is Matt Connerton Unleashed in the afternoon, and we are live, for real. For real, we are live on WMNH 95.3 FM, emanating from a pretty nice, feels like spring. I guess there's some winter weather coming, but it feels like spring outside, sort of. Fairly mild. Nice, bright, sunny day here on here in Manchester, New Hampshire, rather. So here we are on WMNH 95.3 FM, of course, and on Comcast Channel 97, if you're in Manchester, also streaming at WMNHradio.org and on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. I see John Midas Manning in the Facebook live chat, also known as DJ Midas. Of course, he has a show here on WMNH 95.3 that you can hear every Saturday and then a replay Sunday at midnight, late night delight from midnight to 4 a.m. Great, great stuff. I see Fred Bonig from the dailyripple.org in there as well. Jenny is in there. Hi, Jenny. Chris Rose. Chris Prendergast. Hope I'm saying that correctly. Hello, everybody. And the phone line, I believe, is working because I tried it earlier before the show, and it seemed to be working. So the other day we had an issue with the studio line, or actually for several days, but it looks like it's back up. So you can call us at 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. I mentioned that we're live, for real, actually live, because yesterday I wasn't here, so we reran Monday's show. So I apologize. I hate to miss a show, especially in these very exciting times. I had a personal matter that had to be dealt with yesterday, and it was very time-sensitive, and there was just no getting around it, so we ran a replay. But it's funny because I heard the beginning of the replay. I was in transit, and I'm thinking, geez, you know, it occurred to me that, you know, I make a big deal about saying, you know, we're live at the beginning of the show. So when somebody, even when it's a replay, somebody hears me saying over and over again, we're live. So what are you going to do? Anyway, but and thanks to, of course, Peter White for helping me with that. It was a little bit last minute, that whole thing, so I appreciate his help with that, making sure that a recent episode got loaded in. And speaking of Peter White, so I want to share something, a brief clip. Now this morning on the morning show, something happened that was that I heard. I was listening live. I wasn't able to call in, but I heard something pretty funny. Mike Doyle was on the morning show, and as he usually goes on, I think about once a week. And Mike's been on this show only once, but he's welcome anytime, and he's a frequent caller. And I like Mike a lot. He likes to call me up and give me a hard time, tell me I sound like CNN and all that, which is fine. I don't take it personally. No, I enjoy the discussion, and I like Mike a lot, and he's very good on the radio, and you know, he has some broadcasting experience for many years. He did I think it was called After Further Review, or Upon Further Review, or On Further Review, something Further Review, a sports show that he used to do locally here on Channel 23 in Manchester, and but anyway, so you know, Mike's a Trump guy, And he and Peter were kind of getting into it a little bit. And I enjoyed the interaction so much. And the way Peter kind of finishes it off, it actually had me laughing out loud. So I texted him before the show. I said, Peter, I'm going to play that clip. That was very well done. You know, typically if I play something from the morning show, I usually play this classic moment from the morning show.
Traffic is good. That's it.
Which I believe was the last time the traffic was ever done on the morning show. what happened this morning was very entertaining. And by the way, if you're not familiar with the morning show, it is, of course, weekdays 7 to 9 a.m. live right here on WMNH. I'm running on very little sleep. And I had one of those big Monster Energy drinks a little bit before the show. So, bear that in mind, because what tends to happen when I do that is I talk faster than my mouth will actually move. So sometimes simple phrases come out as blah, 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 blah. Anyway, so the morning show, 7 to 9 a.m. weekdays here on WMNH 95.3. And, of course, if you miss it, you know, just like all the shows are archived at WMNHradio.org. So if you don't get to listen and participate live, of course, you can access them later at your leisure. But I want to play for you what happened this morning. They were kind of Mike Doyle and Peter White. They were kind of getting into it about Trump a little bit. And, you know, think about Peter is, you know, he's not overtly political. You know, if you haven't heard the morning show, it's more fun, you know, light fun, a lot of humor. And they don't really get heavy into politics. I mean, granted, on this show, we get pretty silly sometimes ourselves, but it's usually about something politically related. This is more of a political show. But Peter, you know, he's not overtly political, but he definitely has opinions. And I don't think he's any big fan of Donald Trump. And of course, Mike Doyle is. So here's actually, now that I'm thinking about it, it's like the one time that Peter really talks about national politics is when Mike Doyle is on the show. So anyway, here's what happened this morning. I'll go ahead and play this. Oh, except I need to turn this up. Sorry. Like I said, I'm running on very little sleep. Okay, here we go.
These are statistics that people got caught. How about the ones that we haven't caught?
Exactly. I know what you're talking about there. Now we can get into something.
What?
But people that have been caught and then people that haven't been caught, if you know what I'm saying.
No, I don't. No.
Oh, okay. Oh, all right. I was talking about your favorite president and his organization.
Why do you have to turn it like that?
Well,
we're talking about drugs here, not the president.
Right. Oh, okay.
The president's trying to put up a wall.
Great.
To try to slow the amount of drugs coming into the country. That's all he's trying to do.
Oh, that's it. I know. That's it.
That's a big fight.
He's. I know. He's so.
I know. Why is that?
Oh, yeah.
When's the last time you climbed over a 30-foot wall? Never. I haven't. You haven't.
I don't know.
Because you can't. So why wouldn't we just want to put up walls in sections where it defers these people to checkpoints where we have more?
There are slats. There's slats.
Right. But why didn't they all voted for it when Obama was in office?
Now
Trump's in office and they're all not voting for it. Why is that?
The genius thing is.
That's a simple question.
You know, well, here's a simple question. Why didn't he get this done when you had a Republican Congress?
What does that have to do with anything? He still wants to do it now.
I know, but why didn't he do it before? It's been a crisis since 2016. He did it during the campaign. It's just another failed campaign promise.
And he said for it.
Really? And how do you feel about paying for the wall now? Like after your guy promised you, he made you guys chant it. Mexico is going to pay for it. Who's going to pay for the wall? Mexico. Who's going to pay for the wall? Mexico. The joke is on everybody.
You got to get off CNN.
Don't you get it?
You got to get off CNN.
What do you mean CNN?
Uh-oh. Why'd it stop? Oh, man. It stopped right at the good. What happened here? It just stopped playing. Hang on. I don't know what happened. Bear with me, guys. That's really an odd thing to have happen. Now it just won't play. Oh, something went wrong. It's not the. It's like I'm playing it from my computer. Let's try this again. I'm sorry, guys. I don't know. I think that. Oh, that's the beginning of the show. Let me get it to where it was. I'm sorry. I think the deep state. I think the deep state is interfering again, or maybe it's Q, our friend Q. All right, here we go.
I know, but why didn't he do it before? It's been a crisis since 2016. He did it during the campaign. It's just another failed campaign promise.
All of those people voted for it.
Really? And how do you feel about paying for the wall now? Like after your guy promised you, he made you guys chant it. Mexico is going to pay for it. Who's going to pay for the wall? Mexico. Who's going to pay for the wall? Mexico. The joke is on everybody.
You got to get off CNN.
Don't you get it?
You got to get off CNN.
How? What do you mean CNN?
By the way, okay, I have to interject. First of all, so this is like the most political I've ever heard Peter get, and bravo, sir, bravo. And by the way, and I like Mike Doyle, but just a little maybe constructive criticism, if you want to call it criticism. But that's Mike's go-to is CNN. That's what he like. If you say anything negative about Trump, it's CNN. It can't just be that there's anything negative to say about Trump. Of course not. Our exalted hero. No, anything negative. That's Mike's go. That's what he says when he calls. He goes, "Oh, you sound like CNN. You know, if you're not on the Trump train, then it's because you're." Yeah, I guess because you get all your opinions from CNN, so.
It's a Trump rally.
Those are the talking points.
It's a Trump rally. What does that have to do with our crisis? It's not CNN.
Let's talk about the crisis.
I'm just saying.
You're trying to avoid it.
This is about the crisis and the wall.
So how do we stop the drugs coming over?
He lied to you like he did many other times.
How do we stop the drugs coming over the border?
He lied to you like he did many other times.
Simple question. What would be Peter White's theory?
I live in little old New Hampshire, man. Come on.
And stopping drugs.
Right. Little old New Hampshire.
Let me give you the last stat. 373, the number of overdoses in New Hampshire in 2018. That's more than one a day.
Okay.
People die.
We know we have a crisis.
So he's trying to stop it.
Right. Oh, okay. Yeah. Watch. Put the wall up. Watch how the numbers go down. Give me a break. Most of those things come in at like port of entries.
Oh, stop.
They do. They prove this. Your guy is the biggest effing liar that you could possibly imagine. He had no part of Russia. Oh, wait a minute. I did. I was working with them. It's just lie after lie.
What happened to 2 years of collusion and now nothing? They can't find anything.
Well, what do you mean?
I mean, what happened? Where's that all gone?
I don't know. Half his campaign staff is in jail.
All for stuff in the jail.
Right. Your guy is just a known liar.
Stop now. You're being silly.
No, it's not. He's
all
a liar.
For stuff that they did.
Who's paying for the wall now?
Pre-Trump.
Who's paying for the wall now?
Right.
Who was going to pay for the wall?
All for stuff.
Why can't you answer my questions?
Stick to point.
Why can't you answer my questions?
All for stuff that they did.
Why can't you answer my questions?
They're in jail.
I answered your question. Who did he say was going to pay
CNN.
For the wall?
You got to get off the Clinton News Network.
No, it has nothing to do with CNN.
Oh, this it does.
I'm asking you, what did candidate President Donald Trump say? What did he say?
Are you stuck on that?
Who was going to pay for the wall? I'm asking you, why can't you answer me?
He said Mexico will pay for the wall.
Okay, and now they're not. Who's paying for it?
Well, I don't know. We are probably.
Right. Now, that's a lie. It's a failed campaign promise.
That's a lie.
But now listening to Peter White. Call us at
250-6W. So bravo, Peter White. Very well done. And I just love so he finally he finally gets Mike Doyle to admit that Trump lied about that and then goes right into the segment with Carol. I just thought I heard that live when it was happening live and I was like, oh, that's funny. He did that to Glenn once too. Glenn R.J. Willette, the people's mayor. This was months and months ago, so I don't have the clip, but I wouldn't know how to find it. But Glenn was talking about something. Might have had something to do with public bathrooms. Imagine that. And he was going on and on about something, and then Glenn goes, "And another thing." And right when Glenn says, he said, "And just one more thing." And then right when he says just one more thing, Peter goes right to the music, and it was just, the timing was brilliant. So there you go. So Peter White, that was the most politically argumentative I've ever heard him, but fighting the good fight there. So well done, sir. And of course, if you want to hear the whole show, like I said, it is all the shows are archived at WMNHradio.org. Let's see, in the Facebook live chat, hello to Ricky Litwinkowicz, who joins us in there. Oh, Brian Brody. Hello, Brian. Brian from All Natural Bean. Let's see. So I'll give the number again. The studio line is, to the best of my knowledge, working, because I did test it before the show. It is up. 603-250-6007. 603-250-6007. We did have a someone I thought we were going to have a guest in today, but he kind of stopped communicating with me at one point, which made me think that that he might not be coming in. So, but that's okay, because there's always a million things going on in the world to discuss. So when we last left off, because I wasn't here yesterday, but Wednesday, of course, we focused largely on the, well, almost entirely, really, on the Michael Cohen testimony. And then yesterday, the big news was, well, actually the night before, but into yesterday, the big news was the didn't work out with Kim Jong-un and our president, Donald John Trump. Sometimes things just don't work out. You know, they fell in love, according to Trump, but it just didn't work out. And Trump said sometimes you have to walk. And but he's still saying very, very glowing, lovely things. Oh, hello to Christian Cunard in the Facebook live chat. Still speaking very warmly of Kim Jong-un and a little too warmly for some folks, actually, because there was this gentleman, Otto Warmbier, who, of course, was returned to the United States in a coma. By the North Koreans, and apparently Warmbier's parents had a problem with all the praise that is being lavished on Kim Jong-un. Oh, imagine that. Of course, Trump says that apparently Kim Jong-un was not aware of how Warmbier was being treated, of the mistreatment that he was suffering that led to him being in a coma and ultimately dying. Kim Jong-un didn't know. I would assume that during their meeting, Kim Jong-un probably very strongly and very firmly denied knowing anything about it, much like Vladimir Putin very firmly, very strongly denied, you know, any Russian interference into the election. I'm sure it was the, you know, I'm sure it was the same type of situation, you know, when when a dictator who murders people very strongly denies something, why wouldn't Trump believe that?
Could be other people also. There's a lot of people out there.
So, you know, what can you do? By the way, so I've never forgotten this, and I've never heard another person bring this up. But during one of the Republican debates in 2016, when he had like Trump and like 9 or 10 other people on the stage, and Ted Cruz, one of the questions, you know, and I'll actually give Trump a tiny bit of credit here for answering this, trying to give a sincere answer to this question. Although I always hate this question, because 9 times out of 10, none of the candidates will answer it sincerely, and they'll try to spin it into something that benefits them. But so the question was, well, what is a weakness that you have, right? And, you know, and of course, most candidates will try to answer it as, you know, kind of like they're in a job interview, which in a sense a debate is, right? You know, and try to spin it into something positive, like I remember years ago, well, back in 2008 during the Democratic debates when that was a question. And John Edwards, Senator John Edwards, answered something like, well, some people might say I'm too impatient for change, but it's just because I love this country so much that I really, really want change. And of course, it was just a really douchey answer. Trump actually seemingly somewhat sincerely said during one of the Republican debates that he was, if there's one thing he might be guilty of, it's being too trusting of people sometimes. You know, people tell him things and he takes them at their word. And I think we might be seeing this play out now, both with Putin and with Kim Jong-un. But we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Oh, good way to test the phone. Who's on the line?
John C. Hopwood.
Okay, the studio line is definitely working again, which is nice because that means I don't have to plug my cell phone into the board. Hello, John C. Hopwood. How are you? And what does the C stand for today?
Quad.
Cod?
No, quad.
Quad?
Quad. My middle name is Quad.
Claude? Oh, Claude. I thought you were saying cod, like the fish. I was very confused. I'm not into seafood, personally. Frankly, I find it repulsive. Please don't call and talk about
what
cod.
What happened to Glenn's voice? Oh, I'm driving right now, so.
Oh, my goodness. You're going to get a ticket.
Nah, I'm not in Manchester. No. Hey, what happened to Glenn's voice?
What do you mean?
Why is Glenn against public toilets all of a sudden?
I don't know what you're talking about. We don't really talk about Glenn or play any Glenn audio on the show. I don't know what you're talking about Claude.
Our public.
If that is your real name.
Our public toilet. Oh, sorry.
No, there was...
I apologize.
There was some other guy talking about that, but not Glenn R.J. Ouellette, the people's mayor.
Oh, yeah. I was wondering why he thinks that public toilets promote weakness.
Oh, I don't think Glenn would say that. I think he's very pro-public toilet. And besides, I don't know if he's even on that kick anymore. I think he's got bigger fish to fry. Get it? I was taking it back to the whole, it was kind of a callback to the cod thing.
Oh.
I'm very clever
hey,
that way.
Do you think that Glenn harping about the public crappers is a political weakness?
I don't know. I don't really, we don't really do local politics on the show, so I don't really have an opinion, to be honest with you.
Oh, he's not running for mayor, I hear.
I have no idea if he is or he's not. All I know, I do know this.
I just F-bombed, sorry.
What?
I gotta go right now.
All right. Well, I just hit the dump button because he says he just F-bombed. I didn't hear it, but I hit the dump button anyway, just to be better safe than sorry. Okay. So that was confusing. Anyway, so now Trump is saying his remarks on Warmbier were misinterpreted, according to TheHill.com. Oh, hello to Ed Murphy, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. Says here, Trump today sought to clean up his widely criticized claim that North Korean leader Kim Jong-un did not know about the death of U.S. college student Otto Warmbier, saying, quote, "Of course I hold North Korea responsible for Warmbier's mistreatment and death," unquote. Let's see. He then went on to say, obviously I meant to say wouldn't. When I said would, hopefully that clears it. No, I'm kidding. That's actually a reference to his post-Putin remarks. No, he said in a pair of tweets, Trump claimed that his initial comments at a Thursday news conference following his failed nuclear summit with Kim were misinterpreted. There is a pattern here, right? I mean, even those of you who love and adore our president, Donald John Trump, and don't get me wrong, I'm not suggesting he's not just the greatest president in the history of the galaxy, certainly. I would never question him in any way because he's so truly remarkable. But you have to admit, though, there is a pattern here, right? You know, he did the his press conference there, his joint press conference with his BFF, Vlad, and then had to, say, oh, no, I meant to say wouldn't when I said would, or would when I said wouldn't, or something like that, right? And now he's having to clean this up after a press conference without his other, well, Vlad's his BFF. He and Kim fell in love, so I get, but they don't seem to be getting along. So, you know, what would you say, his Korean lover? I don't know. That sounds, actually, I think that's the name of a film that I used to watch when I was a kid on the Scrambled cable channel where you couldn't actually see anything. You ever do that when you were a kid? Anyway, no, but there does seem to be a pattern of this. So here's what Trump tweeted. First, he said, I never liked me, but I didn't have a chance to pre-read any of this. So I'm absorbing this for the first time. He said, I never like being misinterpreted. Let me stop there before I even read the rest of the tweet. Dude, if you don't like being misinterpreted, try speaking the English language like someone who didn't learn English 2 weeks ago. Like, I mean, he makes Sarah Palin, of all people, sound mildly articulate, okay? If you don't like being misinterpreted, try speaking in a way that doesn't leave lots of room for people to go, okay, I don't know what that meant, but here's what I think it might have meant. You know what I mean? Like, he makes George W. Bush sound like Doris Kearns Goodwin. I mean, he really is. He has to be the least articulate, least well-spoken president in the history of the world. Now, again, don't you Trump people, don't get all upset with me now. I know, even as, you know, even as much difficulty as he has speaking English and stringing coherent sentences together, he's still a great president. I'm sure. I have no doubt about it. So don't get all upset with me now. Anyway, so he tweets, I never like being misinterpreted, but especially when it comes to Otto Warmbier and his great family. Remember, I got Otto out along with three others. The previous administration did nothing, and he was taken on their watch. Of course, I hold North Korea responsible. And then some ellipses, because now we go on to the next tweet. For Otto's mistreatment and death, most important, Otto Warmbier will not have died in vain. Oh, God, no. Don't go there, dude. Don't do the died in vain thing or didn't die. Oh, no. Oh, that is so cringe-inducing. When anyone does that, oh, that makes me cringe. That's so bad. Don't even go there. Oh, no. Oh, don't ever do that. No one should ever do that for any... Oh, well, they didn't die in vain. No, screw you. Yeah, tell his family, oh, well, hey, you know, he didn't die in vain. Oh, that's such a bad thing to say. The level, no offense to anyone who's ever said that, but the level of, the lack of self-awareness it takes to even utter a phrase like that about someone's death is staggering. Oh. Like I said, I didn't pre-read this. Oh, hello to Patrick Henry in the Facebook live chat, who says, ha, 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 ha. Ed Murphy says, yes. Canadian scramble porn, loved it. Yes. Oh, well, that's not what I meant, Ed Murphy. How dare you? No, that is what I meant. Let's see. Okay. Well, anyway, I'll read the rest of the tweet, but oh, God. Okay. Most important, Otto Warmbier will not have died in vain. Oh. Sorry, I keep getting stuck in that. It's just I don't have a bucket here to throw up in, so I'm struggling a little bit. Otto and his family have become a tremendous symbol of strong passion and strength, which will last for many years into the future. I love Otto and think of him often. Oh, my God. What? Dude. I love Otto and think of him often. Oh, jeez. So, yeah, I mean, I understand the president's not wanting to appear like a sociopath, but this is kind of a bit of, isn't this a bit of an overcorrection? You know, I love Otto and I think of him often. Dude, you don't love him and you only think of him because you have to deal with this because this is in your face, okay? Oh, everything about that tweet is cringe. Oh, my God. Dude, stop. Let's see. In his remarks in Vietnam, Trump said that Kim had denied any knowledge of Warmbier's treatment. And, of course, Trump said, quote, and I will take him at his word. He knew the kid. Can you imagine? No wonder Otto Warmbier's parents are so angry. Oh, my God. Can you imagine? Bad enough what happened to their kid. But then you've got this clown who... Oh, my God. I just, like, you know, and I'm trying to make fun of Trump for it, but at the same time, as a person of empathy, I'm sort of trying to make light of it in terms of Trump, because I'm trying to not be overwhelmed with anger, because I can't help but think about how Otto Warmbier's parents must feel having to watch this inarticulate buffoon of a clown of a president try to navigate this. I mean, it's disgraceful. And, you know, I know all you pro-Trump folks, you don't see it that way. And but this is really gross. I'm sorry, but it is. Oh, God. All right. I'm going to read the rest of this quote, but I'm actually, like I said, I'm trying to be funny about it because it's Trump, but I'm actually legitimately getting really angry and very sad at the same time. Okay, so Trump said that Kim had denied any knowledge of Warmbier's treatment, quote, and I will take him at his word. He knew the case very well, but he knew it later. And you know, you've got a lot of people, big country, a lot of people. And in those prisons and those camps, you have a lot of people. And some really bad things happened to Otto. Some really bad things, unquote. Okay. Whatever. Jeez. And of course, you know, polling data consistently shows that at least 40% of the country is just fine with all of this. This blithering buffoon who, you know, can't even remotely fake sympathy and empathy without just embarrassing. Well, you know, those of us who actually care about other people and who actually care about what Otto Warmbier's family is going through, for us, this is embarrassing. As Americans, this is embarrassing. Now, again, at least 40% of the country who's with Trump no matter what, you guys are fine with it. You know, I'm sure somebody on Fox News has probably figured out some way to tell the audience that, well, Otto Warmbier probably did something to deserve it. He probably had it coming somehow, and these parents shouldn't be criticizing the president. I'm sure that spin is out there. I'm sure at some point Laura Ingraham or some other sociopath has gone out of their way to somehow think of something really terrible to say about Otto Warmbier's family or something. I'm sure that's happened, and I'm sure at least 40% of you just eat that up and think it's just fine. But it's not fine. This is not okay. And I'm getting a little sick of pretending that this is normal. 40% of you think this is just fine. This is normal. This is not normal. This is infuriating. The best thing this clown could do is shut the hell up and just, you know, let this family try not to embarrass everybody and let this family have some peace instead of just making everything worse. He just makes it worse. And I don't know what makes me angrier. Him? Or just knowing that at least 40%, or maybe a little lower, I think I've seen maybe 38%, somewhere between 38 and 45%, depending on what poll you look at, possibly as much as 45% of you think this is just dandy. And it's not. Sorry. Let's see. God, I don't even know where to go from there. I think, no. I mean, maybe I'm a little emotional because I'm exhausted, but, you know, hasn't been a great couple of days, but I can't take this in and think about what his parents must be going through and just be okay with it. I can't. A lot of you can. I can't. I think we need to play my favorite one of my favorite political song parodies, this Michael Cohen parody of Lawyers, Guns, and Money, this His Lawyer Bums Some Money by Rocky Mountain Mike, because Michael Cohen has been quite the focus of this week, and I think we could all agree that I might need a minute. So let's do this and kind of reset, and this is fun to listen to, and I'll be back.
Way he'd always do. How are we to know? He'd get with the Russians too. They were peeing there in Moscow, and Cullen's in on this. His lawyer bumped some money, yeah, to get him out of this. Hey! He's the president's own fixer, and somehow he got stuck between that Trump and some hard time, and he might just be. Yes, he's down on his luck. Yes, he might just be. He's talking with Stephanopoulos. He's a desperate man. Trump's lawyer needs some money. The shithead's not a fan.
Hey everybody, it's Matt Connerton Unleashed in the afternoon. We are live on WMNH 95.3. I don't know why John Hopwood is knocking. He always throws me though when I see that red hat on his head. I think he's gone over to the other side, if you know what I mean. By the way, Michael Cohen, of course, according to Cohen's testimony, Trump knew everything about the payments to the adult film actress, Miss Clifford. Is it Clifford or Clifford's? Rudy Giuliani back in... I was wondering the other day what happened to Rudy Giuliani. Were they hiding him? Were they trying to keep him from doing anything damaging? According to Mediaite, Rudy Giuliani says Trump didn't know about Stormy Daniels' payments at the time. So he's contradicting, of course, what Michael Cohen says. Hello to Jackie Brown, better known as G-Girl, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. I see Matt DaCosta in there, Gia Soares. She says, that's right, it's not okay, tell him, referring to what we were discussing earlier, which I don't want to get back into because I don't want to lose my mind again. And what is it? What, you sound like Trump when you're sniffing over there. And,
Are they eating in the studio again?
I certainly hope not. That is prohibited in this establishment. And hello to Levy Brew in the Facebook live chat, whom I had the pleasure of interviewing on the show a few months ago. What's up with, are you?
There's something obnoxious here, like something that hit a windshield.
Oh, really?
Yeah, how do you clean one of these screens?
You know, I'm not exactly sure.
You're a radio professional.
Yeah, I'm not a cleaning professional. I don't know.
Don't you keep it clean?
Just lick it off or something.
Don't you keep it clean? How do you keep it clean?
I don't know.
Glenn was
soap
here.
Soap and water?
If Glenn RJ was here.
He never comes on anymore.
Why's that?
I don't know.
Huh. He is involved with that secret organization.
Oh, we're not supposed to talk about that. That's a secret organization.
I didn't know state police could arrest people just driving.
What do you mean?
I didn't know they could make traffic stops.
State police? Of course they do. What do you mean? You see them on the highway all the time pulling people over.
Well, I lived in California and Chips couldn't do certain things.
Oh, Chips Patrol. Ponch and John.
They had to, couldn't use the radar for almost the entire time I lived there. That was great. They'd have to follow you for a mile. And.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so if you were observant. Yeah. I don't think I ever got a ticket in California.
Oh.
Speeding, that is.
Right.
And I had New Hampshire plates for the first 3 years, so, you know, I parked wherever I wanted to.
Oh, wow. Mm. Very good. Very good.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Do you think that people should be able to vote in New Hampshire even if they don't want to live here?
Even if they don't want to live here?
Yeah, they have no intention of living here.
No.
That's going on, though. Now the Democratic Party is suing Bill Gardner and his lieutenant over the fact that if you do vote here, within 90 days, you're supposed to get a driver's license.
Wait.
Or I guess an ID. Well, to show that you intend to live in the state of New Hampshire.
So what are the Democrats suing over? I'm confused.
Well, the ACLU already sued, saying that that requirement is a poll tax.
Oh, okay.
They're representing a woman from young woman from California going to Dartmouth who wants to vote in New Hampshire, but she doesn't intend to register a car or get a license.
Yeah.
See, when I was in Boston University for 4 years, I kept my New Hampshire license, and I voted in New Hampshire.
Oh.
I didn't vote in Massachusetts.
Right, right. Yeah.
You know, my vote, in fact, in California, you can't vote except in a federal election, unless you've lived there for 366 days.
Really? Yeah?
Yeah, that's New York State, too.
Oh, okay.
Which, these are very liberal states, too.
Yes, yes.
And you have to register your car within a certain amount of time. I think it's 90 days. Florida used to be even worse.
Yeah.
And they would go after you. Not so much in California in the early 90s.
Oh, okay.
Since I drove around with the New Hampshire plate so long. Now they got the computers that talk to each other. It really sucks. You know, Ontario, if you have a New York license, the points from Ontario go on your New York license.
Yeah.
Do we have points in New Hampshire?
Oh, yeah.
We do?
We do, because I remember...
That's communism.
I remember when I first started driving, I was a bad driver in the beginning. Like, you know, like when I was 17.
And is that before your tail was bobbed?
Well, we won't talk about that, but how dare you? That's very personal. But I remember being worried because I got a lot of, like, speeding tickets and whatnot, and I remember being worried about losing my license, but the points never quite caught up to me, so I was never in danger of losing my license. But I remember being worried about it because we have a point system.
Oh, hell, I grew up when if your chin could get over the counter at the liquor store, you could buy booze.
Oh, my mother would send me to the corner store to buy cigarettes for her. And you know, it wasn't a big deal. I mean, the owner knew her anyway, so, but still, I mean, that wouldn't fly now.
You know, from the age of 12 onward, I was the only guy at Parkside Junior High, I don't know what they call it now, and at West High, within my circle, that had the guts, I was going to use a word, you know, probably shouldn't use on Christian radio, WMNH, or whatever it is.
Well, you know, our very expensive, just to remind you, our very expensive demographic research does show that 98% and a half of this audience is Christian evangelicals.
A little less than a bar of Ivory Soap.
And the other 1.5% is children under the age of 9, which is very strange.
Yeah, they do occasionally call in.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, I was the only one that had the guts to go buy a Playboy. So you'd buy it for $1, and I'd sell it for $2.
And they would sell the store would sell you the Playboy?
Yeah, why wouldn't they?
Wow.
Well, you know,
they wouldn't now.
Sometimes there would be an old maid behind the counter, you know. But you had to know where to go. There used to be a place in Pinardville, Buywise.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's not there anymore.
Oh, I remember Buywise, actually.
So if there were the old coot was on, you could just, you know, go buy anything.
Did you see any of Michael Cohen's testimony?
No, I don't follow the news. Mm. I heard you having a meltdown over some Korean guy died.
Yeah, we're not going to get back into that. No, It wasn't a Korean. It was an American guy who died. But apparently less than half of those surveyed in a new poll found Michael Cohen's public testimony to Congress to be credible.
Jeez, I think I've gained like 2.5 kilos since I went off that pill.
2.5 kilos? You make it sound like you're smuggling drugs.
Well, you know, Joel's right. You know, they don't use the metric system in the United States, but it can be handy, you know. It kind of like your weight, it like underplays it significantly. And other measurements, you know, like if you say like 15 centimeters rather than something else, makes you sound kind of stunning.
Oh, wow.
Particularly in the personal ads.
Oh, I can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Says 37% of registered voters contacted for the Hill-Harris X poll said they found Cohen's testimony credible, compared to 25% who said they did not find him credible. 39% said they had not yet formed an opinion of Cohen's testimony.
There used to be only two polls in the 70s. There was the, Gallup poll.
Yep.
And there was the Harris poll. But there was an obscure celebrity in a time before everybody could just become a celebrity, Phil Harris. And he used to appear on shows like Wide World Sports when they'd go fishing or something. Oh. And he was a friend, I guess, of Bing Crosby. And whenever I hear Harris report, I just think about Phil Harris.
Oh!
You know, it's strange back then because, you know, we were utterly inundated by media, according to the pundits of the time. But yet it was less now. Like, I always used to wonder about Norm Crosby was this obscure comedian. But he was always on talk shows and stuff. And I'd always associate with Bill Cosby, who I guess we can't talk about him anymore. He really bored me.
Bill Cosby? You didn't enjoy his colorful sweaters?
They make us listen to his comedy album during, you know, like sometime when... Remember, I don't know what it's like when you went to school, but when things started breaking down, they'd bring audio visuals out, you know? Some god-awful 16-millimeter film or... You know, there'd be a substitute teacher. We'd have to his genius stroke would be to listen to a Bill Cosby album, which later I realized he was stealing a lot of Gene Shepherd's material.
Now, somebody had made a comedian had made a joke. Might have been Bill Maher, who said, "Could you imagine if someone had gone back in time, like to the '80s when you were a kid or however old you were in the '80s, and told you that in 2019." Bill Cosby would be in prison and Donald Trump would be president. Like you wouldn't believe it.
Bill Cosby maybe, but not the Donald Trump.
You would have believed that Bill Cosby would be in prison?
Totally
in the 80s?
Would.
Well, that's true.
Jeez, the things that people still get away with are shocking.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
So do you have experience with security clearances and stuff, right?
What are we talking about? I thought we were talking about Norm Crosby. Is it Norm Crosby or Norm Cosby?
Well, you said Crosby, but then you said Cosby reminded you of him, which didn't make sense because you said Crosby, not Cosby.
There used to be Merv Griffin and Mike Douglas. They used to have talk shows. And they used to have people on. They'd even have writers on. Can you imagine that?
Well, this is interesting. Gia in the Facebook live chat says, Bill Cosby always gave me the creeps. Now I know why. Interesting.
He was good and nice spy. I have a funny story about that, but I'll tell you off camera.
Oh, my goodness.
Off whatever.
It must be
off air.
It must be salacious
in
nature.
It's very sensitive.
Oh, my goodness.
It has to do about the year 19, when it went into reruns.
Oh, okay. Jared Kushner, are you familiar with him, the son-in-law of our president, Donald John Trump?
Yeah, I heard about him. Somebody was talking about him yesterday.
Yeah.
But I just think it was some type of crosstalk inside my skull.
Oh, right. Yeah. So it was you talking with yourself?
Could have been the virtual Glenn, maybe.
It could have been.
I hear he's on the lam.
Oh, well, I'm just glad to know he's still alive. Well, there's a big kerfuffle over Jared Kushner's security clearance.
What kind of clearance does he have? Do they say?
I think he has top security. I think he has the nuclear codes, actually. Very disconcerting. But even Fox News's Chris Wallace called out Kellyanne Conway this afternoon for her response to the big New York Times report on Trump ordering Kushner to get top secret security clearance despite concerns from intel officials. It's top secret. So does that mean he, like, knows everything?
There's different levels of top secret.
Oh, okay.
there's a confidential. Then they created, after 9/11, something beneath confidential, which was ridiculous, and used it to prosecute whistleblowers going backwards, like the air marshal that revealed that they were putting air marshals on short flights, which have no chance of anything, any terrorist trying to take over, because it's a short trunk flight, rather than on the long, you know, not just intercontinental flights. I don't know if they have them. They must have marshals on intercontinental flights, but, you know, flights that go Boston to L.A., New York to San Francisco. What would you call that? Cross-country flights.
Oh.
Long flights. And so to boost the numbers. So they go, you know, they reclassified information about that to something underclassified, and then they busted the guy.
Oh, okay.
Jeez.
Wow.
But in top secret, there's, like, I had a top secret SCI, but my brother was 23 steps above me. He did black ops. So, you know, there's all sorts of levels.
Oh, all right.
I think that, you know.
Well, the Democrats want some sort of hearing about this or something, about Kushner.
Why?
Well, and his security clearance. Oh, hello to Peter White in the Facebook live chat.
Because of Russia?
Because Kushner is, why does he get to have a security clearance? What has he done to earn a security
clearance?
He's
on the president's staff.
Yes.
Isn't that
true?
Take it security
clearance.
But his
father is a criminal. And
so?
And is in prison.
That doesn't.
I say revoke his clearance.
We don't lose your clearance.
Revoke it now.
In my time, the only thing, he would have been restricted about certain information about Israel, being Jewish.
Oh, okay.
You know, I don't know if that's still. And the people that would listen in on the Israelis were mostly Mormons. But, you know, Mormons were very common in the intelligence community.
I think part of the problem with Kushner is because intel, all the people Trump is against, his intelligence officers and so forth, expressed some concerns because Kushner was never fully vetted.
Well, the thing about the Mormons, you didn't ask me the question, it's not something out of the blue. It's just, as a Mormon, you know, you go on a mission, they really stress you learn a language. Like John Huntsman knows Chinese.
Kushner's a Mormon? I thought he was Jewish.
No, I said why Mormons were in the intelligence community.
Oh.
I met a couple of Mormons that learned Hebrew, and they would spy on Israel. Jews weren't allowed to in the 80s.
I see.
As a security clearance. Britain, it's similar, too, with different people. If you come from different, like Hong Kong, they won't let you deal with the Chinese, or even Hong Kong or the Chinese.
For Mormons, I would think it'd be hard to, like, really go out and spy on people when you got all these wives at home you got to take care of.
They're patriots.
Oh, okay. Well, that's true. Well, Mitt Romney certainly is a great great American.
Think about it. You got, at home, you got, you know, a regular translation factory.
And what's his name? The other guy. John
Mitt
Huntsman.
Romney.
No, John Huntsman.
I just
said
Mitt
Romney.
He knew Chinese. He's fluent. And
Mitt Romney knows Chinese or John Huntsman?
Romney's French.
Yeah, Huntsman knows Chinese.
Right, and he did his mission in France. Everybody goes on a mission. Every male, maybe women now, too.
Oh.
You know, so that's why they're an intelligence asset. But as for Kushner, the only reason you would criticize it if he had anything to do with Russia.
Mm.
But that was before he had a clearance, but, you know.
Mm.
I don't know how much they vet people in the cabinet.
Do you know about Charles Kushner?
Yeah, he got arrested.
Yeah, Fred posted in the Facebook live chat. He, let's see, in 2005, he was convicted of illegal campaign contributions, tax evasion, and witness tampering. He served 14 months in federal prison and resumed his career in real estate after his release.
That's called tincture of blood. And they tried to pull that during the McCarthy era. Like if your father or mother or uncle was a communist, they'd take your security clearance.
Oh.
But the Supreme Court, I think the middle Warren Court struck that down.
Oh,
which
okay.
Is, you know, it's ridiculous to think the sins of the fathers.
Yes.
You know, as long as it's us and Trump, we can, you know, we take away every consideration of humanity from them and vice versa, right? You know, if it's the issue of what he did with Russia. You know.
Yes. Sean Hannity may have opened himself up to being subpoenaed.
The entertainer?
Yes. He's, by the way, not to pick on anyone's appearance, but don't you? I've always thought Hannity, there's something very simian looking about him. He looks like an angry ape man.
I don't know.
Like the Kinks song.
He looks human to me, you know.
Oops.
You have a different perspective on these things.
I do.
Being, was it Homo correctus?
How dare you?
Homo correctus.
Oh.
Yeti.
I am very correct. About most things. Here, I want to, this is a very short clip, but I want to, I haven't had a chance to really take this in. This is Hannity. This is from just the other day, I think. Yeah. Oh, this is from last night, actually. Oh, never mind. We have a call. We'll get to that.
Let's it must this, be Fred.
Could be Fred. Hi, welcome to Matt Connors and Unleashed. Is this Fred?
It's Dave Ridley.
Hey, Matt, Mike Doyle.
Oh, it's Mike
Doyle.
Daryl.
Daryl?
How you doing?
Good, how are you? John Hopwood good, pronounces good. Your name
hey,
funny.
I was heading to my wake of my cousin. I just kind of turned your show on, and I caught you playing the morning stuff.
Yes.
I noticed you conveniently left out the statistics that I read before we started that conversation about drugs, and it was simply about drugs. And how some of the, my point was being that a lot of the Democrats are saying there's no crisis, there's no big problem with drugs, there's no, and that was my point. I wanted to talk about drugs, not Trump, but what I would ask you is, in mimicking that show that you played, and I don't know if you find it funny or not, it doesn't matter, but.
Well, that's why I played it. Like I explained, I just thought it was a fun, funny moment. There was no other agenda there.
Right. What is your solution? What is a simple solution or some kind of solution to the drug crisis we have going on in this country?
Well, we've talked about it. I certainly don't think it's building a wall, which is not to say that a wall in certain places wouldn't necessarily be a benefit. I'm not as totally against it as you might think. But we've talked about it before. I mean, the last time we talked about it, I blew your mind. You were so shocked, even though it's always been my position. For one thing, I would like to end the drug war, put the drug cartels out of business by bringing everything into the sunlight and decriminalize hard drugs. And I actually think that would help. They did that in Portugal, and drug use went down. Yeah. What we do now, I think, makes it worse.
They have national health care.
I'm not sure you can do that with drugs like fentanyl. Maybe weed, maybe, you know, some, maybe cocaine, but not, I don't know about fentanyl.
Cocaine.
Which
you know how addictive that is?
Which 66 pounds of fentanyl that they apprehended in New Hampshire in 2017 on one drug bust is enough to kill 30 million Americans. I mean, don't you think that's something we've got to get a handle on? I'm worried about the youth, the future youth of this country. Is
youth?
That, the younger generation that just, I guess, doesn't understand how dangerous this is.
Utes.
Yeah, no, they need to be educated on it.
Utes.
Right.
But
two other points, though. They had on, Fox had on the director of the Border Patrol under Obama for 7 years. And he clearly said we definitely need more walls in certain places to deflect people from coming over and pushing them towards places where we have more agents at borders so we can try to at least minimize the amount of drugs that are coming over.
I don't necessarily disagree, Mike, that in some places, you know, putting up walls or barriers would be bad. I don't know that we need to spend $5.7 billion on what Trump wants. But I don't out of hand dismiss the idea that in certain places, if the Border Patrol agrees, you know, and the experts agree that more wall here would be helpful, I'm fine with it.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't understand why when in 2000, I think it was 2012, 13, the vote came up under Obama, and it was almost unanimous democratically to fund the wall.
Yeah, the Republicans killed it.
Now, Trump's asking for the exact same thing, and the answer is 100% no. How does that work?
Well, I don't think Trump's asking for the exact same thing. Doesn't he want to build a wall from sea to shining sea?
Well, I don't know. He's,
or steel slats or something?
Whatever the Border Patrol tells them and where they think they need it most. He said that.
Have you ever been to Brownsville, Texas?
No.
They have the Barbed Wire Museum.
Oh.
That's a cheap alternative.
Oh, barbed wire?
One more thing. I heard your thing about racism yesterday. It was a good show. And, you know, so anytime you can open up the mind of that, disgusting, you know, thing called racism, or as you put it, you know, you have a different name for it. But I personally feel that whenever we talk about it, it just adds to it. It just adds fuel to the fire. You should kind of ignore it. Just, you know what?
Oh, my.
People that are morons are going to...
They're gonna lynch people. We don't need any laws.
No, Mike, I could not disagree more. I hear this a lot from Republicans, though. Oh, just ignore it and it goes away. It does not go away, especially in the social media era that we live in, with the rise of anti-Semitism online. You see what happened in Charlottesville. You have to confront it, Mike. It's a cancer. It's malignant, and if you don't confront it, it spreads.
You're never gonna stop it.
You gotta confront it.
They stopped lynching, didn't they? They stopped lynchings, didn't they, Mike?
What?
Lynchings? There were 20 lynchings every year. My father lived in the South.
Should have ignored them. They would have just stopped on their own, I guess.
They stopped because of the federal government intervening.
Yeah, you got to confront it, Mike. I couldn't disagree with you more on that. You have to confront. It's a cancer. You cannot just ignore it. It spreads. The more you ignore it, it spreads. You got to confront it.
What does that do? What does confronting it do? Nothing.
Are you crazy? How old are you?
We should have just. We should have just stuck with separate water fountains. I mean, why do anything about it, right?
No, I'm not saying that.
Stop them from voting.
People who are ignorant are going to be ignorant.
Why are you telling them
on the radio that you're an ignorant racist? You're not going to stop them. They're ignorant. They're stupid. They're the same color. We're all made from the same mass.
Right.
So.
It's odd to me though, Mike, that I mean, I appreciate you're saying that you liked what I had to say about it, but I'm getting a mixed message from you, because you're saying you liked what I had to say and that I was talking about it, but then you're saying we shouldn't talk about it. We should ignore it. I don't. It's like you're saying two different things. I don't understand.
What I meant to say was I understand what you were saying, not that I liked it. I should have said,
oh, okay.
I understand what you were saying.
You understood what I was saying, but you'd prefer I didn't say it.
I just think guys that are idiots and racists, right?
Yeah.
Are gonna feed off you being mad that they're racist and bringing it up. That's a win for them because they're ignorant people. They don't understand we're all the same.
Right.
There's nothing you can do about that.
No,
the more
but
you talk about it, the more you feed into them, saying, "I got him to talk about it."
Part of it, Mike, is it's cathartic for me, and I think for a lot of people, because, you know, because I think racists are so stupid, I personally get something out of calling them stupid. Like, I actually like the idea, and maybe this is narcissistic of me, but I actually like the idea of someone racist stumbling onto my show while they're driving in their car, hearing me talk about how stupid they are. And just, you know, making sure that person knows that I think they're stupid for being racist. You know, like, I want stupid people to know that I think that they're stupid. That makes me feel good. Just hopefully I've offended them in some way as much as they've offended me. You know, I want them, you know what I mean?
I think that's my point. I think you don't understand that they're enjoying watching you call them a racist. They're enjoying it. They're enjoying hearing that you're upset that they're racist and stuff. It pisses them off. I mean, it makes them happy that I don't know. That's just the way I feel, because people who are racist are just ignorant. They're just ignorant people.
Well, they are.
You know what I mean?
They are, but I don't know that it upsets. I mean, there's different levels of racism. There's different levels of racism, and there's different kinds of racists. And there's definitely some racists, Mike, who if you call them racist, they actually do get upset. Because they're so ignorant, they don't even know that they're racist, or they don't understand that their behavior is racist. Some people actually do get very offended and very pissed. And I like the idea of offending. And I like the idea of offending those people.
Yeah, I guess. So that's more of a self-narcissistic thing you enjoy. Calling them out on it versus letting them have no podium to be racist besides what they want to do in their own life.
They do have a podium.
Yeah, I don't know. I hate racism. I hate it each way. You've got plenty of white people that are ignorant to black. You got plenty of black people that are ignorant or white. I mean, there's plenty of people that hate white people.
No,
and it's just either way. You know what I mean?
People
don't realize if you're in trouble and you call a cop and he comes to your house and he happens to be a black guy, are you going to say, "Don't help me"?
Right.
You know what I mean? It's just silly.
No, we agree.
And vice versa.
We agree on that part. Absolutely. Yeah. I think we disagree on how to approach it or whether to approach it. But
yeah, John, it's an approach thing. You're right.
But John Hopwood. No, your heart's in the right place, Mike. But John Hopwood did have a question for you.
Well, it's for have you ever heard of David Irving? He's a historian.
Name's familiar.
No.
You know, he's. I don't know if he has a PhD because in the UK and England, you don't necessarily have to have a PhD. And when he went through university in the early 60s, he was a historian, a very well-known historian. He's the one who wrote the first book about the Allied bombing of Dresden, which had been covered up for a generation. Well, every year, Mike, he would come here to Manchester. When I was with freelancer for Yahoo News, I wrote about the last time he came here. It was always in secret, but I was able to get on the bulletin boards that were announcing his appearance here. This was once one of the most respected historians of World War II. He was involved with the Hitler diaries and proving they were fake. I think he was the one who proved they were fake. You know why he was here, Mike? He's the number one Holocaust denier in the entire world. Number one Holocaust denier. So revealing that in Yahoo News, was that giving him publicity? Shortly thereafter, the Obama administration banned him from the United States. They took away his ability. You know, he can't get a visa to the United States anymore.
Yeah. So why would that's my point? Why was he coming here?
He's coming here to
get some kind of news.
He was coming here to meet with Nazis, neo Nazis in New Hampshire, which are here. I've met people from. Right wing type of, not Aryan Nations itself, but affiliated groups. But I'll tell you what, and this would support what you're saying. I'm not going to name their names, but they were here in New Hampshire. I actually went down and met somebody, a friend of mine, who was in the FBI, to talk about it, and said, you know. But this was a time under Obama; they weren't rampant.
You're talking about this guy David Irving,
right?
Who should have zero talk.
Why?
Because he's a moron. He's not a moron.
He's a brilliant guy, and he's very, very clever about his Holocaust denial. It's a bunch of crap when you get onto it, but he's a very clever man that actually believes it and builds a case that falls apart after you study it. I believe people should be able. You should have Holocaust deniers. Should have a platform because then you can just go about and you can logically destroy them.
Right.
But here was a guy doing this in secret without publicity to meet neo-Nazis here in the state of New Hampshire.
Right.
So I gave him some publicity.
So he's a brilliant man who believes there was no Holocaust.
Who denies, phrase that Hitler, first thing was that Hitler had no knowledge of the Holocaust. Eventually, his denial got bigger and bigger and bigger. And then there was a famous libel lawsuit where another professor. He sued, I think, for libel, and she made the case.
You got to question the word brilliant.
Often brilliant people can be racist.
There was
scientific racism.
You can be smart and still be evil, to really just kind of hyper-simplify it. But, I mean, you can be smart and be evil, and that's why you have to confront this stuff, because smart people know how to recruit other people into their evil.
He made a clever argument.
Right. That's how you recruit people, is you make a clever argument and people fall for it.
And he used him as an authority.
Right.
Now exposing him and them.
Exactly. Exposing. I'm glad you used that word. And that's why you got to confront this stuff. Otherwise, the lemmings fall for it.
But New Hampshire and Manchester have this thing where nobody talks about anything going on.
Mm.
Let's think about, scandals and We don't even want to bring them up, like the scandals in churches. It's very painful to deal with stuff like that,
Yeah.
Particularly if you're from the church or have, like my mother from a church that was rocked by a scandal.
Right.
Stuff like
that. I won't tie you up anymore, but I'm just trying to find solutions. I'm trying to find some way to stem the drug problem besides your theory of make and everything just opened the doors to legality for everything.
Hey, you know,
China, I'm worried about the future of this country. I'm worried about the next generation.
I am too. We don't disagree on the problems. We just disagree on approaches. That's all.
I agree about you. One thing is, you know, if you don't have people where drugs are coming in, people don't get busted, and you have no statistics. But conversely, you're talking about if you don't talk about certain stuff, you'll never have statistics or knowledge about the stuff.
Yeah.
So, and the other thing, yeah, I'm a person, I've gone over a 40-foot wall. That was in basic training, though.
Oh, yes.
And there was a guy below me pushing me up, and a guy above me pulling me over.
All right, Mike. Well, thank you for the call, my friend.
Right.
Always appreciate it.
All right, man. Talk to you later. Good show.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye. Let's see. We got to catch up with the chat room here.
We're talking to Mike. It's like, you know, I think he's from Manchester, and people do have, I think, that mindset, you know, about certain things, like, let's say, violence in our schools.
Yeah.
Nobody talks about anything.
Well, I think, too, though, with what Mike was talking about specifically, like, right after Charlottesville happened, like so many, a lot of conservatives will tell you, I think Mike's more of a moderate Republican. That's my impression of him. But a lot of conservatives. Like people, like just in one-to-one conversations I had with people who would say to me, no, the problem is you got to ignore these people. Just ignore them. They're idiots. Just ignore them and they'll go away. And it's like, no. When you got people walking around with tiki torches chanting anti-Semitic slogans in public, you cannot just ignore that. You need to take pictures of those people and put them online and embarrass them and get them fired from their jobs and do whatever you can do to humiliate them and, direct some, you know, there should be consequences for that, you know? So, like I kept saying, it's a cancer.
Social lynching?
Yeah, social lynching, I like
that. They
used
to do that to so-called communists back in the 40s and 50s.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't do that, but when we're talking about hate, you got, like I said, it's a cancer, it's malignant, it spreads if it goes unchecked. We have another call.
Oh, I have I'll bring up an example from the 70s.
Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
It could only be one person now.
Is it Dave Ridley?
Fred, I'm always glad to hear from you, but I'm especially glad to hear from you when you've been very, very active in the chat room because it's too much to catch up with. It's easier to just talk to you than try to read all of this.
Yeah.
It's hard.
Well, I was putting information so that other people when John was talking about the guy, the historian, I put his stuff there so that people could catch up with him because he has a tendency, because he's so smart and so has so much of the stuff in his head that not everybody's on the same page. So I was just trying to keep up with him.
Yeah.
Putting information so they could see.
He is a very.
What he was talking about. Because he's usually right about that stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not being contrary.
He's a very. that's right.
That too.
That's right.
He's of course, now the other guy, you know, that was the one that I really wanted to talk about.
Mike Doyle, yes.
It was our buddy Mike.
Yes.
And Mike is wrong on a whole lot of things. First thing is Cato did a research project on the fence, and they found out what lowered the amount of drugs was exactly what you said. Legalizing marijuana made it so that they, you know, the same amount of fence has been there, but since they – legalized marijuana, the amount of it that's coming into the country has totally declined, and all that data is in that last link that I put there.
Okay.
So it's not about the fence. It's about the money and the if you don't have the buyer, you don't have,
buy cocaine.
it from the guy down the street and go to jail, or you can go just down the street and go to the store and get it at the store.
Cocaine is the classic example. Destroyed Colombia and other countries. It's the demand from North America, which in the, you know, until recently meant U.S. and Canada.
Right.
Mexicans would never call themselves North America. North Americans was used. But the demand from North America for cocaine.
Yes.
Right.
And it's so expensive, becomes such a lucrative industry.
Yes.
And the more you make it harder to get in,
right,
the price goes up.
Yep.
And it makes it even more lucrative.
That's right.
You destroy countries, and if you're an addict, you're going to get your cocaine, I guess, but I'm not sorry. That is a highly addictive drug.
I've never
been able to afford
I've never tried it, but
I have.
But I
I just like the way it smells.
I've talked about it on the show before, like years ago in the summer. It was the summer of 2004. I dated a girl who was a Coke dealer. And I don't say her name because if I did, people locally would recognize who she might even be listening to the show. But
is she a state senator or something?
No, but she's someone who worked in radio and no longer does. But
I won't corner it down to anybody.
Jeez, everybody knows who it is. No, let's not get into stuff.
No,
like
you
that.
No.
Here you can probably figure anybody out.
It's not important, and it just people here locally in Manchester would know. But yeah, and let's see, what else were you putting in there? Oh, by the way, Fred, so you said something about Mike. Do you still use the N-word, referring to Mike?
Yeah,
because
my question was that people. I'm not saying that he did.
Oh, I'd be shocked.
But people don't do that because of of public shaming.
Right. Exactly.
That became, and it worked.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. Yeah. And let's be very clear about that. You're not accusing him of using that word.
No. But I'm saying nobody does use it. You know, I mean, it's not politically correct. It's
exactly.
Not, and it's through shaming.
Exactly. Yes. Confronting the problem and exposing it.
What about typos? what was it?
Fred. Yeah.
A bigger became.
Fred doesn't know about this.
And we don't need to talk about it.
Well, we have to just say. I mean, there was a certain individual who on Facebook.
Yeah, I had a typo instead of A bigger, you know, by shifting one key, it becomes S.
Yeah.
And
it caused
I was complaining about, there was a riot. I was covering for Yahoo the riot with the up in Concord when the Bloomberg bus came.
Yeah.
And I knew some of those people. It's like, geez,
yeah.
They're just going crazy. And,
yeah.
I'm not going to mention his name, but I know this guy since I was a kid. And
yeah.
He had a contract with the Concord police supplying them firearms. He later apologized, but it was just. And so I'm typing like a tweet or something.
Yeah.
A bigger or something became out.
Yeah.
And so now I'm accused of being a racist by former flower shop maven.
Let that be a lesson, kids. You have to proofread everything before you post.
It's a Twitter. Why didn't you change it?
And you might want to remind that to the Kavafi president. Anyway.
Yeah, no kidding.
But it's.
One of those things, though, the public shaming has. And shunning and,
man.
You know, and divesting from people financially, you know, the same thing as like boycotting people's products and boycotting people's sponsors and stuff.
Dalton
Those
Trumbo.
Things actually do. They don't change people's hearts. They just change their behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yes.
And that's the first thing. That's the minimum you can do.
Right.
Where he's saying, you know, people are going to be racist. They're always going to be racist. You know, maybe they're not, because if you're shamed into it, you may not act that way in front of your children.
Right. Yes.
Kids need to be carefully taught.
Great, great point,
Fred. They destroyed socialism after, you know, not so in World War I, but they really took a whack at it over after World War II and just stomped it out, you know, blacklisting and all that. They even went and got Arthur Miller.
Well, my favorite one now on that, is, and I love that exactly what you said there, John, because my favorite one now is when they, you know, when the conservatives talk about socialism, I always go, you mean like Israel, where they have universal health care, where they have liberal abortion policies, where they have strict gun laws, where they subsidize their colleges, where they have 30% union membership, and where their total high taxes is 47%. Oh, you mean like Canada, where they have mandatory universal health care, they have universal background checks, they have unrestricted at any point in the pregnancy abortion laws, and they subsidize their colleges, they have a 30% membership in the unions, and their high tax rate is 33%.
And look, they didn't have a
blacklist. Those are socialist countries, right?
Oh, yeah, rampant communism. Israel was formed by the Labor Party, you know, the old Labor Party of Ben-Gurion. The thing was, the Hollywood 10 that were blacklisted, they kind of like whitewashed them after the 70s. And you find out they actually were communists under party discipline. And their apparatchik, John Howard Lawson, a playwright and then a screenwriter, he was actually, you know, under Hans, not Hans Geisler, that was his brother, Gerhard Eisler, who was a commentator, well-known very violent person. But you know, that's an interesting thing. So there's a little irony what I was saying about the McCarthy period. But you know, you can the brush was done too broadly, you know.
Yes.
But when you're talking about shunning and everything, but they didn't have that. But and when you really look at the Red Scare after the war, it was basically about the labor unions. They knew who the communists were because, like, one of the persons that was blacklisted, one of the Hollywood Ten, spoke out in the Daily Worker for, you know, freedom from being controlled by Moscow, and he was slapped on, and he took the party discipline. But it wasn't them. They just went after, like, everybody, and it was basically to, you know, they wanted company-friendly labor unions rather than more militant unions. Because, like, Howard Zinn was a member of they always say, oh, he was a member of a communist party. But he wasn't a communist party. The American Labor Party of New York, which was, oh, that was a communist front. And Howard was not a communist and that, you know. But so when you start shunning and talking about everybody, you know, a lot of people can fall into the cracks rather innocently. Because you could say something like, I did it with you once. I'm like, oh, you never have any black people here.
Right.
I was in one of my moods.
Yes, yes.
That was smart. I never thought about such a thing, but we were arguing about something.
Right, yeah.
And then you just jump right in, you know?
Yes, yes.
But, yeah, but definitely you're right, you know. The change in race, attitudes about race,
yeah,
was...
Fred, I want to ask you this, because we're talking about this the other day on the show, and people tend to disagree with me on this, but I do think, as far as racism itself, I really believe that it gets better with every generation.
I think it has to do with the fact that because of integration,
yes,
because of integration, the kids of today. You know, they're around people other than the people their parents were around, because most of their parents were in, like, white neighborhoods. There wasn't any black people.
Right.
And after, you know, and then so the next kids go to school and they become friends, because if you put two kids together, it doesn't matter. They're going to become friends.
Right.
And they become friends, and then they, you know, the girls and the boys, you know, that what happens then. And the next thing you know, everybody's got relations that are, you know, as they said in Oh Brother Where Art Thou, they become miscegenated. And so because of the mixing of races, we're browning of America, because there's so much of that, that it's real hard. Like, that's what Meadows had the problem with. See, because he talked trash.
Oh, Mark Meadows.
About
yeah.
Obama yeah. going back to Kenya, and he didn't say his kids, but his niece and his nephew, which means his brother or sister's kids, were, you know, part African American.
Right.
So it means, you know, and especially in North Carolina.
I mean, yes.
So you start talking about these generations. It when America's all brown and they have curly hair, we'll all be fine.
Right, because there's no racism inside groups, which isn't true at all.
Right.
No, you're right. You know, you are, what right. you're saying is so naive. First of all, I lived, you know, through the 70s. We didn't have busing or anything here. And down south, you have busing academies. You know, what you're talking about, integration. The thing that happened, you know, there was violence. The 70s. You're just exaggerating this stuff and using what I call a blue sky thing. If anything brought the races together, it'd be that African Americans, Hispanics, everything come up in economically, and people interact economically.
Well, I think Fred was giving one example of how we've.
To say that within ethnic groups, you know, first of all, there's a situation here I'm not going to talk where somebody took a person from actually Africa and assumes that the. Said to them, oh, you know, you're against your own people, which is crazy. You know, it's just not understanding Africa or people. They're nations. It's just not one thing, African or blacks. Within the black community, read The Color Purple. There's all sorts of castes. The caste system in India, you know, they always say that that's based on color to a degree. You know, the Dravidians, the original people, were darker. I mean, you're talking about something. If anything's going to end this, it's economic opportunity to people that were just kept in virtual bondage.
Well,
if you're talking about integration that way, yes.
Allowing people of other races to buy homes. Now, I know that sounds silly.
They have an economic opportunity.
Way to transfer wealth to buy, you know what I mean? It's mm-hmm. because
I support reparations.
In the neighborhoods, back when I guess Levittown, the perfect example, Levittown,
which
was
one?
A white community that when the soldiers came back from the war, they all could buy homes in these white communities where the values of the homes went up. When those values went up, those people sold those homes or they gave them to their children or whatever, but they were able to accumulate wealth and transfer wealth. Transferring wealth in the black community because the house, their neighborhoods didn't necessarily go up in value. They may have went down in value. They were forced to stay in there. They weren't allowed to buy in the other neighborhoods. And so it's about transferring wealth to the next generation. And unless you can do that, it's real hard to have a across the board kind of move up
mm-hmm.
because you have to be able right. to transfer wealth. And some of the best ways to make wealth is through real estate, and real estate
oh, of course,
kind of
yeah.
separated from them mm-hmm. for a long time. The opportunity was
right.
gone. Now it's illegal to do that.
Right.
You know, but I mean that changing that helped a lot.
It helped tremendously
to transfer wealth.
And that was a conscious act. Those were laws put into place. Johnson in California. It was Pat Brown who lost his bid for a fourth term to Ronald Reagan, who rode the reaction against the Fair Housing Act partially. That was partially, you know, it's hard to get four terms in a row. But, and yeah. it would be, I could just say that it was, you know, he was riding the wave of racism, whatever. It's more complex than that.
Yeah.
But yeah, the Fair Housing Act in California was, they passed one too. And whites reacted, middle class reacted against it.
Yeah,
because it struck down covenants in neighborhoods.
The felony laws also, because you cannot own, you cannot have a hair salon if you have a felony. So creating felony laws that were specifically to influence or impact minority communities, because that's the kind of the crimes that were in those communities, they made them felonies. It's the same thing, the difference between cocaine and crack cocaine. You know,
right.
those kind of things. Making laws like that, because with a felony, you can't own a business. So you can't get a job. You can't do a lot of things. And you can, and to make somebody have a felony because of, like, pot or something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah.
Or, you know.
Oh, geez, that was
those
egregious.
Kind of laws were designed to keep people, minorities from having money.
Well, and poor people too. And,
right.
yeah.
and
yeah.
racism and economics go hand in hand.
Of course.
Yeah.
Generational
and
poverty.
Keep them from owning a gun.
In Texas, you could have less than a you know a joint. You'd get these horrific sentences
oh, sure.
into the 1970s, if not afterwards.
Oh, no doubt.
Yeah.
yeah. Absolutely.
Right. And if you, and the three-time loser one, you get caught with a joint three times.
Oh, Jesus.
We you have go to prison for life.
In California, through an initiative, they passed the three strikes you're outlaw, thinking it was going to be about, you know, felons, violent
right.
felons. It turns out one guy goes to for life, some old fart, because, you know, he might have had an assault. But then he wrote a bad check, and the last time he stole somebody's air conditioner, and it was considered a felony.
Yeah.
And so all of a sudden, all these people are going to jail that are just like these petty grifters.
Or,
and that was an old fart white guy.
Or
you know?
Their third strike is just a low-level drug offense.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, which normally wouldn't add up to much, but yeah.
Crime is an industry. I mean, crime is an industry for the criminals, but it also is for the people that go after crime. Prisons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The union, the guards, prison guard
complex.
Union was so powerful in
yeah.
California. The corruption of it and its campaign contributions brought Gray Davis down, the California governor. I'll never forget voting for that. I should have voted for the little African-American actor, the midget. Or Larry Flynn.
The midget, they're short people.
Oh, Vern Troyer? Was
well, 223 people were on the ballot. We recalled Gray Davis.
No, I remember that vividly.
I voted like a Democrat. I voted for him, even though I didn't like him. And then I voted for, you know, if he gets recalled, I voted against the recall. Who do you want to vote for? So I voted for him. Now, I could have voted for, like, Sonny Bono or somebody.
Well,
I've been proud of my vote.
Let's see if you guys remember this. Comedy Central did a one-episode game show called Who Wants to Be Governor of California.
It was like a booklet.
Do either of you remember who won?
Gary Coleman?
No. Nope.
Is it Gary Coleman?
It was porn star Mary Carey, I think is her name.
Oh, that's right. She was on it,
wow.
too.
Yes.
And a woman that had a bordello in San Francisco yeah. or near Nevada, near the Nevada-California border.
You got to love porn stars. You know, they're going to change the world, you know. There's a porn star by the name of Stormy Daniels that may end up being the reason what causes the impeachment of a president.
Yeah, she's maybe. Not even, you know, she comes from that part of Kentucky that's not even America. So there could be a little, you know, legend.
She is a distinguished adult film actress. How dare you both?
She was related to Hillbilly Jim, wasn't she?
No, it's fine. Mm. Whatever she is, it's fine. But she's okay. The one story that ended up bringing Cohen to his knees. I mean, literally. But,
oh, you know, no, it was Trump, literally.
It was the money that he paid off to shut her up is the felony that is now, you know, we have the check.
Unless he gets another term and it runs out for him, the statute of limitations.
Oh, that's right, the statute of limitations. Right?
Now, there's an American success story, Stormy. She came to the country, you know, and Hillbilly Jim's charger with the 500-gallon tank of mm-hmm. moonshine.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they just worked their way right up to the top.
Yes.
From the bottom. Yeah, didn't she have a song under a different permutation? Looking up from the bottom or something.
She was
part of the Carrie Nations. I think you can look it up.
Oh, okay.
Let me see if I can find it. I'll send it to you.
Oh, there was another thing.
Well, I'll let you guys go. I just wanted to say hi. And
you were right.
And look at that article about from Cato.
Yes.
That's at the bottom of the list there that talks about how it is the legalization of marijuana that's not the fence that's actually lowering the drugs that are coming into the country, and they have all the data there and everything. It's all laid out.
Absolutely.
And the fact that when we put the fence in, it increased the number of people that died by five times.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
Because they had to go into harder areas to get across.
Yeah. Okay.
So, you know, and these are moms and kids and stuff trying to get in,
mm-hmm.
and they had to go to places that were not fenced. And by doing that, they had to cross some of the worst terrain, the desert and all this. And they've increased the number of people that are dying trying to get here. Because
they're dying to get here.
They're making a new law that says, okay, you come here, we process you just like we did
mm-hmm.
in Ellis Island. And you get to come in and here's your working papers and you get to pay taxes now.
Right.
My family's, the three of my, what is it, great-grandparents, didn't come through Ellis Island. They slipped over the border of Canada.
Oh, my goodness.
Atta boy.
Nobody cared. There were no immigration laws in 1922.
Right, right. All right, Fred. Well, thank you so much for the call, my friend.
Talk to you later, boss.
All right, take care.
Bye, John.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
I hate it when Fred's right.
The great Fred Bonig from thedailyripple.org. When he was right about, I heard you blurt out that he's right, but what was he right about specifically?
Everything today.
Oh, yes, yes.
It's irritating.
Oh, yeah, it bothered you. I don't even remember. What was the big argument that you and Fred got into that one day? There was one day you guys argued about.
I was arguing against what I actually believed, so he's able to tie me up.
Oh, yes, you were being contrary.
Which was very frustrating.
Yes.
There's only so much you can defend when you're full of the, poop.
Yes, the merd.
Poop.
As Merd I've heard Z. You say. What's Merd Z? Is that the
it's
same thing?
It's a French-Canadian word from the west side of Manchester.
Oh, wow. Oh, my goodness.
What's your weekend going to be like?
I don't know. Hopefully it's sunny and warm. Oh, we're getting snow, actually, aren't we?
How much?
I don't know. I think only a very little bit. But as far as I'm concerned, March 1st is the first day of spring, damn it.
What's her name? Stephanie, whatever. It became Stormy Daniels. She's a member of the Carrie Nations. It's look on up from the bottom, or is it look on up to the bottom? I sent it to you.
I have no idea. You sent it to me where?
To your telephone.
You texted it to me?
The Carrie Nations, look on up at the bottom. It's a classic song from, I think, 1970. I think they opened for the Strawberry Alarm Clock.
Oh.
Do you know who the Strawberry Alarm Clock is?
I do, actually. Oh, Mike Doyle, I apologize. I did not see your email in time. But
bigger.
I'll throw this out anyway, because hopefully Fred is still listening. He can answer in the chat room, or he's welcome to call back if he wants. But Mike said, ask Fred if fentanyl should be legal.
I don't believe fentanyl does do all the stuff it said to.
What do you mean?
I don't know. I just feel like being contrary.
Oh, okay.
Contrary.
You're going to get
C. John C. Hoppitt.
You're going to get all tied up in knots.
Say something, and I'll contradict you.
Oh, Gia says it was Gary Coleman. Remember, we were talking about a... you can't say midget anymore, right?
I thought Gary Coleman was that white guy that was in all those bad TV shows, like The Sixth Sense.
Are you thinking of Gary Cole, the actor?
Yeah. Oh. He was in the Brady Bunch movie.
Yes, he was, which was terrible. Oh, God.
Not the first one.
I saw that in the theater.
I'll hit you.
You like that
movie? You don't like the Brady Bunch, do you?
The Brady Bunch.
The Brady Kids. Then there was the Brady Brides. Jeez, we're going to be like the morning show.
I know. We're talking about...
Look on up at the bottom.
Look on up at the bottom, huh?
Yeah, it's a hell of a song.
There is... actually, here, I'll tell you what I... I'll play it for you. I'll play just quickly what I enjoy about the Brady Bunch.
Here's the story of a shameless grifter and the con men who were running his campaign. They were sucking on the teat of Mother Russia and also of Ukraine. It's the story of a guy named Putin who was rigging the electoral outcome, sending agents from the GRU to say, GRU dumb. And these agents met with Manafort and Sessions, Carter Page and Roger Stone and Michael Flynn, Jared Kushner and Donald Jr. Now what deep borscht they're in. Yeah, they're saying Papadopoulos will topple us, and Robert Mueller will have us all for lunch. Oh, but he is not inviting, he's indicting. That's the way they all became the Shady Bunch. The Shady Bunch. The Shady Bunch. That's the way they became the Shady Bunch. In a way, even Trump can't counterpunch.
So there you go.
I think Trump's going to get reelected.
Oh, I think if he survives the Mueller probe, I think he will, because...
I disagree with you.
Do you? Oh, yeah. You're being contrary again. What's that? What'd you put up there? What'd you,
it's a Tulsi 2020.
Here's the song,
Tulsi?
You were talking about this, Carrie Nation.
This was, Stormy Daniels' first gig.
Oh.
I think she's the lead vocal.
It does vaguely, sound like porn music.
Oh, boy.
It seems you had a bad affair.
Oh, my. So you,
There's nothing obscene in it, although it was from an X-rated movie.
Yeah, I was going to say.
It was from Beyond the Valley of the Dolls.
Oh, okay.
Russ Meyer.
Now, what's, Tulsi is your candidate, right?
Tulsi and Bernie.
Oh.
I'm supporting him as a ticket.
Oh, you are? So who do you want to be on top?
You know, who's going to ride topside?
Yeah.
I always figure that a woman should ride topside.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you want Tulsi to be president and Bernie to be a VP?
If it was the W administration, it was, he was looking up from the bottom, W, wasn't he?
I don't see Bernie on the bottom, do you?
Have you seen Vice, the movie?
No, I want to.
I do, too.
Yeah, I want to see that.
It's a great actor.
Yeah.
I think Christian Bale. You know, denying Amy Adams the Oscar is a reverse racism, said contrary John.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, yeah.
You're so contrary. Yeah. My goodness. That'll get you all tied up in knots.
Do you know that you originally in English pronounced the K?
I like this song.
I like Knot.
They would pronounce it Knot?
Yeah, and Knick, too, for night.
Really?
Knick, yeah.
Oh, that's
kind of like in Yiddish, Knish or something. I don't know.
What's wrong with them? Why don't they learn to speak English?
Well, they were English.
Yeah, well, they should learn to speak American.
It was those Normans.
Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, there were people there. Then the Celts came. Then the Romans. Then the Angles. Then the Saxons. Then the Danes. Then finally the Normans came there. And that's, I traced myself to a Norman knight from 1230.
Mm.
That's how I'm related to Princess Di's progeny.
That's how we got Norman Fell on Three's Company.
That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, he was a great character actor.
Do you remember the Ropers?
Yeah, but he was...
That only lasted a season.
Yeah.
This really is like the morning show.
Yeah.
Except on the morning show, they don't play a song that was in an adult film.
It wasn't an adult film. It was an X-rated film.
What's the difference? Now we're quibbling over semantics, I think.
Well, adult films didn't go through the MPAA. This did.
Oh.
Although Russ Meyer directed it, he was the first big, not the greatest director of softcore porn films.
Oh.
Nudie Cuties, beginning with The Immoral Mr. Tease.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you've never seen Super Vixens? That's a hell of a movie.
I'm sure it is.
It is.
Oh, goodness.
Violent. It was all about Russ Meyer. I should do a show about him. All the men, it was about these sexually insatiable women.
Mm-hmm.
It was all heterosexual. Dumb men. What do they call it? You know, with big jaws and tiny brains. And, of course, the women were Zach Tigg in a certain direction, you know.
Like Sean Hannity. He's got the big jaw and the tiny, you know.
Oh, yeah, and stupid. You know, he'd have been a Russ Meyer protagonist and always bested by the women.
Let's see. Fred, we got an answer for Mike Doyle from Fred.
About Russ Meyer?
No, about fentanyl. He says, or fentanyl. I guess it's actually fentanyl, right?
Fentanyl.
I don't know why I say fentanyl. He says fentanyl is only popular because of heroin addictions. If heroin was decriminalized, we would see the death rate from fentanyl decline. And there's an article here that Fred shared.
If heroin was legal, I'd take some, because in small doses, opiate helps with PTSD.
Ah.
But you'd have to be very careful.
Yeah, there's an article here Fred shared, how Europe's heroin capital solved its overdose crisis.
Portugal or Amsterdam?
Says Europe.
What's the capital?
The capital of Europe?
Well, the capital of the EU, I know what it should Brussels.
Be. Oh.
The muscles from Brussels, it was Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Oh, he shared another link, too.
You're not into movies, are
you? Oh, no, that is the same one. I love movies.
I almost said the S word in the past tense on the Brady Bunch movie, which is, you know.
Well, the Brady Bunch movie was terrible.
You're thinking about the Brady Bunch sequel, a very Brady sequel. That was god awful.
Maybe I am, actually.
First one was okay, was good.
I think you're right, actually. I think
second
you're right.
Was god I think, awful.
No, I think you're right. I think I am thinking of the second
god
one.
God awful. I always had a thing for Jan, but that was because she was my age. She's the middle one, right? She was my age.
No.
Now she probably still is my age. She's a painter now, out in Cali.
No, isn't Jan the oldest?
No, that's Marsha.
Oh, right. You're right.
Who's the brat? Cindy.
Cindy, yeah.
Oh, she didn't get invited back for some of the movies and stuff, the TV movies.
Oh, well. Well, didn't she get into adult films?
No, you're thinking about the dame from with the two little black brothers and the obnoxious guy.
No. Cindy Brady did too.
No way.
Yes, I remember her going on Howard
Peter
Stern.
Peter White, are you there?
It.
You're thinking of Diane Plato.
We're almost out of time.
She OD'd on like a Vicodin.
No, I know, but Cindy Brady. I'm going to Google this real quick.
No way.
Yes.
I'm going to hit you with my cane.
Did I just ruin your?
As long as it wasn't Jan.
Did I just ruin your entire childhood?
You know, Marsha used to go to Studio 54.
Susan Olson worked in porn for $50. Susan Olson, and says
liar.
And says
black liar.
This is from DailyMail.com.
The Daily Mail. What's that? Is it the Mail from London?
This is from 2015. It's titled, "Here's a Story of a Lovely Lady." Brady Bunch's Susan Olson reveals she was paid $50 to work in porn and says co-star Maureen McCormick is the oddest bird. I don't care about that part, but Maureen McCormick was Jan, right?
No, she was Marsha.
She was
Marsha.
I mean, Marsha.
Marsha.
That's what I meant. But yeah, see, so I was right. So you can be contrary about that all you want to,
remember,
but Cindy Brady did porn.
In the movie, the Jan was she schizoaffective or had schizophrenia?
I don't remember.
It's tough being a middle child. I was the baby of my...